Rise. Let us go to prayer. Father in heaven, we come before you on this day and we ask you to bless us as we step into your presence, that we might bless you by our praise and our worship. We come now to visit you, O Holy One, in a special way in this place, and to visit with one another around your throne. So we ask that you would gather us in by your angels and lift up our hearts and our minds and our voices to you, that we might be changed in this moment into your beautiful, beautiful presence. And we might be changed forever by it when we leave this place. To you be all glory in the heavens forever and ever. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Hope you all find something really fun to do today. It's going to be probably one of the last. Here he is. It's probably going to be at least one of the last nice days of this week. Towards the end of the week, it looks like it's going to get nice, but we're going to get a couple of days of cooler weather. So anyway, try to get outside and enjoy yourself. Praise the Lord for this beautiful, beautiful day that we're going to have. You ready, Maestro?
Sure am.
One, two, three, four. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Till the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come, willingly we choose to surrender our lives. Willingly our knees will bow. With all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, we gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Praise you, God. that will not let me go. I rest my weary soul in thee. I give thee back the life I owe, that in thine ocean depths it flow may richer fuller be. O life that follows all my way, I yield my flickering torch to thee. My heart restores its borrowed ray, that in thy sunshine's blaze its day may brighter, fairer be. O joy that seekest me through pain, I cannot close my heart to thee. I trace the rainbow through the rain and feel the promise is not vain, that morn shall tear this pain. O cross that lifted up my head, I dare not ask to fly from thee. I lay in dust thy glory dead, and from the ground there blossoms red life that shall end this be. Folks, you're going to enjoy a rarity today. Normally, I'm up here like a little chatterbox, but I'm just introspective.
Oh, sorry.
But David's not, and David's really? Going to lead us into this one. David, standing on the promises. You know, what else can we do? What else can we do but stand on God's promises? And his promises are good.
Amen.
He's got some good promises. I wish he were running for president of the United States right now.
On the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises I cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises that I can see. Pray for present cleansing in the blood for me, standing in the liberty that Christ makes free. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, bound to Him eternally by love's strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Thank you, David.
Sure.
Okay. As we continue playing this next worship tune, you may use this opportunity to bring forth your tithes and your offerings. There are two collection plates on either side, located at either end of the stage. And those of you that wish to give or are listening online can go to www.clintonnazarene.org and follow the prompts.
Of true delight, whom I unseen adore, unveil thy beauties to my sight, that I might love thee more. Oh, that I might love thee more. Thy glory o'er creation shines, but in thy sacred word I read in fairer, brighter lines, my bleeding, dying Lord. See my bleeding, dying Lord. 'Tis there where I'm my comfort true, and sin and sorrow rise. Thy love with cheering beams of hope my fainting heart supplies. Oh, my fainting heart supplies. But I too soon the pleasing scene is clouded o'er with pain. My gloomy fears rise dark between, and I again complain. Oh, and I again complain. Jesus, my Lord, my life, oh, come with blissful ray. Break radiant through the shades of night and chase my fears away. Won't you chase my fears away? Then shall my soul with rapture trace the wonders of thy love. But the full glories of thy face are only known above. They are only known above.
time for the family prayer time. Yeah. What a cutie, huh?
Hi, Frankie.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the gift of new life, the gift of the renewal of life that we see in our children and our grandchildren and all around us. We are so thankful that you renew our time on the earth by the next generation, that you renew us with your spirit as we walk on this earth. We are thankful, Father, for the ability that we have to please you by doing two things, believing and remembering. Help us to be a believing and remembering people as we go through these days that are ahead. Help us to remember our past and how it is being misshapen now in the future so that we can lead others to the right understanding of what was and what should still be. Help us to be a believing people, telling people the good news that there is something better than all of this. Something awaiting, a new kingdom is coming that we will all enter into if we believe in you, remember you, and tell others about you. To you be all glory in the heavens forever and ever, Lord Jesus, and all of God's people say.
Amen. Amen. And now, children, come forward because it's time for the magnificent. Magnificent Melinda, not only an incredible barista, but man, can she really teach these kids how to follow the Lord.
Who did
swallow Jonah?
Who did
swallow Jojo?
Who did
swallow Jojo Jonah? Where did swallow Jonah down?
Awesome. Okay, guess what? I usually have some book for a guide, and then sometimes I go off and do my own thing. But for Kids Connection, we kind of did, you guys remember we did Revelation last week? So now guess what? Like our VBS, where do we have to go back to now? The very beginning, which is what book? Genesis, that's right. Okay, so let's see. A lot of you came to VBS. How many of you came to VBS? Raise your hand. Most of you, right? So we had a Bible song, right, that we learned, but I just want to say something first. So what about in the beginning? What was our Bible verse? In the beginning what? You guys, don't tell me you forgot it already. In the beginning. Okay, you say part of it. Okay, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And that's the Bible verse, and then it goes on to talk about the days. So, guess what we're going to do? We're going to sing that song, okay? You guys stand up, and we're going to sing it. Some of them have already seen it, and some of them haven't, okay? Okay, you ready?
Genesis 1:1.
The heavens and the earth.
said swim and fly. They said animals on the land. And then God said, let us make man, Adam and Eve, according to our plan.
Okay, so I'm glad some of you remembered that. It wasn't too long ago. You know, the thing is the whole Bible, I remember when Pastor Scott started seminary, and one of his professors said, what's our faith based on? And the answer was Christology, which means Christ is in everything. Right? All the meanings in the Old Testament and all the meanings in the New he fulfills, right? So, it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Does anybody know, I think we've taught this in the Ignite Homeschool group. What does it say? Let us make man in our image, right? So we know the Trinity is in the beginning, right? God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, okay? So we see Christ in the very beginning, right, creating. And Colossians, I believe, says that all things were made for him and through him and in him, okay? So I want you to remember that, okay? It's super important. Right at the very beginning, and we know that he was already there, right? Because he's God, so he's always been there. But in the very beginning, he created. God isn't created, right? Yeah, it's one of those mysteries. Good question. He has just always been, and he always is, and he always will be, okay? Good question. Good question. How does God... He can't die. That's right. Good job, you guys. Okay, so let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you so much. We are so grateful to see you in everything. Lord, we know that you were in the beginning and you were creating the heavens and the earth with the Father and the Holy Spirit. So we say, give us in our heart a new appreciation for your creation, for all the people in our lives, all the people in our family and our church family and neighbors and beyond, Lord. Help us to remember that they're created in your image, Lord Jesus, and all the beautiful animals and trees and all the other things that you created for your glory, and we can enjoy that too. So thank you for all your creation. In Jesus' name, amen. Good job, guys.
All right, good morning. We have announcements. Let's see. Call Right Worship is our Revelations class. It meets the first and third Monday. Starts at 7 o'clock. Ask you to please join us. It's a great class. Ladies Bible Study meets Thursday mornings with Melinda at 10 o'clock. They're studying 2 Peter and Jude. If you'd like to start participating in that, speak to Melinda. She'd love to have you. Beverly Olson is giving away free furniture. So if there's some furniture you might be looking for, she might have it. So give her a call. Her phone number is right up there, 908-674-2411. Or you can see her. She's here. I don't see her today. Sweet Hour of Prayer, that'll meet tomorrow morning. They meet here at 10:30. They're always looking for more people to come and pray. If you have any questions, you can speak to Nikki about that.
I'll turn on the switch. Before I begin today, I need to kind of tell you what's on my heart. A lot of times I have visions or I see things and I get carried away with that. I can't help myself. Don't know why, but I get enthusiastic. Trouble is I get so enthusiastic that sometimes in the limited amount of time I can find during the week with all the construction happening lately and a lot of other things, I don't really, really plan out real in detail how that's going to look, even though I'm a detailed person. So with that said, as we started looking at these festivals of the Jewish holiday, I realized they're just too big, way too big. So I'm punting on second down. So normally you don't punt on second down. Anybody watch football? In the CFL, you can punt on third down because the CFL isn't real football. Sorry, Canadians. But you know, nobody punts on second down unless they're trying to sneak up on somebody. I'm punting because I need to do a lot more work. So with that said, did anybody get the handouts today? If you got the handouts, please look at this kind of syllabus page. I know that's crazy that I have a syllabus now, but I do. Don't hold me to the week. The weeks are ideas. But I started planning. And when I started planning a way to get us to where we need to be. So a variety of things involved in that, but the basic concept is this. I'm going to lay a bunch of foundation stones, stepping stones, and what I want you to see is kind of like a ladder of stones, kind of going up into heaven. And what I would like you to do is go with me on a journey of stepping stones of the faith. Stand on the next one, stand on the next one. And if I sense we're not there, I'm going to stay right there. Okay, so it could take longer. Is that okay? I think it's really important that we all kind of go together. Everybody okay with that? All right. Now, the next thing. I'm working with Brian. It'll probably take us like 2 weeks, 3 weeks. I'm hoping 2 weeks. I'm hoping 1 week because, you know, I always ask Brian to do the unthinkable and be ready, but he needs time too. We're going to start this thing where, well, I used to call it in college or in high school, clickers. Have you ever seen these things where you can click on the answer and the answer goes up on the screen? Anybody ever seen those? You know what I'm talking about? Anybody ever seen surveys like on the phone or something where you push in something and it goes up there? Well, one of the big things I would love to do is become more interactive with you and slow down a lot and just take my time and you take your time. Now, the beauty of these things is this. You'll be able to use your phone. It's anonymous. If you put anything in there, no one knows who did it. If you don't want to participate, that's anonymous too. The only body that knows you didn't participate is you and God, and that's up to you. It's a choice, right? How many people would like that? I just want to see you raise your hand. Now, it's not anonymous for me to see your hands. How many people would like the opportunity to be able to put it in if you wanted or not put it in if you wanted? How many people would like to get instant feedback to answers? Okay? Okay, it also helps me, okay, as a teacher, preacher, because I can see if you get it or not, right? It's pretty simple. And if you're not, I can go, okay, so it's either failure to communicate, which is usually the case. Okay, starts with the leader. The person didn't communicate it properly, didn't get the right whatever for you to get it, or we just don't know that and we need to know that. Anybody ever feel overwhelmed by how much is in the Bible? All right. Anybody ever feel overwhelmed like you learn something and then you realize it has more layers to it than that? Okay? All right. So that's kind of the concept here. So just quick, a show of hands, how many people think if we did slow down, if we took more time on everything, and if you had a chance to do feedback, how many people would like that? Let me just see. Some of you. Some of you didn't answer at all. The rest of you just didn't care. That's fine. It's okay. All right? You know what? That's typical in a classroom, too. So, all right. So here's the thing. We're going to try these things. And with that said, I'm going to be on this week right now of the foundation of the beginnings. Okay? And so today's worship service is going to revolve around two concepts. This is another thing people always say. Well, I see the questions you ask, but I never know what I'm supposed to learn, some people say. It's like I hear all this, and somehow I don't get it. So I'm going to put it more simply than that. All right? Now, this means I'm going to teach like you're in eighth grade. Now, if you don't like that, come and tell me about it later, okay? But the average person goes between 8th and 12th grade when they learn, okay, even in adulthood, unless they have multiple degrees, and that's all right. So that means I'm going to teach to this level. Are you ready? It's going to be this simple. Today, here we go. We believe, we remember. Everybody try that. We believe, we remember. Now watch. These are the two most important things you'll ever do in your whole life. Because if you don't believe, who will? If you don't remember, who will? How many people realize what's happening to our nation is a failure to believe in anything and not remember anything? Amen? Now, God knew that. God knew that. Listen to me. He knew that. So you know what he says over and over in his scripture? Believe. And when you can't believe, believe again. And when it's impossible for you, it's not impossible for me. Believe. Can you imagine standing at the Red Sea for 1 minute and the chariots are coming in with behind you and you're trapped? What are you thinking? We're done. Can you imagine November 5th is coming and you're thinking, never mind. Okay. You look at this with these, but think about this. They're monumental things that are happening, and you know how important they are. And there doesn't seem to really be a way out. But then God just said to Moses, just lift your hands and stand over the sea and see what I do. Right? And 2 million people, approximately, and about 5 million animals. That's right. That's how big it was. You know how long it takes to take people on a behind a line, even 4 or 5 wide? Do you know how many hours that takes? But what happened? The pillar of fire rose up in front of the chariots and spooked all the horses, right? The water opened and they passed. And then the water didn't close till the whole army was trapped minus Pharaoh. You know why? He wanted Pharaoh to remember too. What I did here. I'm just giving you one example, okay? So when all seems almost, and it is, sometimes hopeless, that's when God's really working, if we believe. So we're going to start with that this morning. There's more music planned, and here's one of them. The words are there up on the screen. They're also in your notes. Let's listen right now to We Believe.
Desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe in this broken generation. So
Must believe for them, because many will never believe. You must believe so that you can teach others to believe. And so we're going to look now at where does our beliefs come from? Well, they start back in the beginning of all things. And so today's message, the first one, is called The Foundation of Our Faith: Creation, Commandments, Covenant, and Promises. To believe is to remember. To remember is to have a history to remember. Think about this. Where do we get everything we believe? From the Bible. Because it's a book of history. It's a book of theology, the study of God. It is a book of science telling us how things weren't and were and came out of nothing. It actually is a book by which we can defend almost any concept of what we believe against all the attacks that come against beliefs. Take creation, for instance, when we get to the next concept. What's the attack? What's been the attack for many years? Evolution. Evolution is a concept that something can become greater over time, smarter over time, more powerful over time, and then be over everything. What did the devil think to himself after God created all the stuff on the earth and all the angels? I, in time, will become greater. I will take you down off your throne. I will replace you. Yes or no? Is that not in the Holy Scriptures? Who's the author of evolution? Satan himself. It's in his own mind. It's how he fell from grace. Seeing God, he still came up with an alternative. And our children and our grandchildren and the college students and everybody's being indoctrinated over and over and over with a way to replace God. the memory of God and what he did. But the Bible doesn't say that at all. As a matter of fact, Melinda was doing the days of creation. Do you know that they actually violate the evolutionary theory? The days aren't even the same way in which they were done according to evolution. Because what came first? Nothing exploded and made everything. That's kind of a weird concept to begin with. Actually, it's the dot at the end of a period full of all the mass and energy in the entire universe. And if you believe that, well, how much hope for you? But when it exploded, it made sun, moon, and stars first so that other things could evolve. But when does our sun and moon and stars begin? Day what? Four. The only planet there was being held in God's hand was just the earth, and then everything came out of around it. And so you have these attacks, and that's just one attack. The attack on life, the attack on other things. It's always against what you already have experienced or know, because you know history. When you don't know history, you don't know anything. And I really get perturbed when people say, oh, it's just a bunch of places and dead people. Lord help us. So there are these essential truths, but first and foremost, there must be history. And I know that the Latin word for it doesn't come down this way, but I find it really unique when we look at it. It's his story. Have you ever seen that in history? I mean, it's just kind of strange that it works out that way. Actually, Geschichte or something else in German is the same thing, what God did. Kind of interesting. Creation. Creation knows better. Watch this. Animals know better than people. You ever read Job? You know what it says? Ask the animals and they will teach you. Ask the birds of the air. Ask the fish of the sea. Ask the animals that dwell on the land. Ask every creeping thing. Do they not know who their creator is? And do you not know, O man, that the very breath you're breathing right now is on loan? It could be taken back right now. It's kind of humbling, isn't it? They just kind of know what to do. You ever notice that? You ever notice like the geese, all of a sudden, they're just all getting in the V formations, and they're all just kind of lining up and getting ready to go south, right? They just know the time. It says right in the Proverbs, the stork and the goose knows it's time and it's season and when to come and when to go, right? So these concepts, the fish all stream, the salmon all go home to Alaska, they all go home to the other Pacific corners. They find the very stream they were in, the very brook, the very tributary, the very trickle of water where their egg was. How in the world do they do that? How about a honeybee? 248 now recorded different moves in the dance. You know that? I can't do it. But they dance in such a way as to give you direction, distance, angle of sun, time of day, type of flower, what to look for, and the other ones go, oh, north by northeast, 12 degrees. Got it, 1 mile. Clover! You ever seen the brain of a bee? It's the size of the head of a pin. What puts us to shame is they know. And we argue. They know, and we don't want to know. I learned enough, thank you. Leave me alone. I'm old now. Kids plugged into computers, tablets, phones, night and day, learning absolutely nothing that will matter. Who knows what I'm talking about? So, we get to the first part. The first stepping stone is creation. And right from the beginning, there's a set of commands, is there not? How many commands did Adam and Eve get when they walked with God in the garden at the end of day six? Does anybody know? How many commands? Two. Yeah. Okay, just two. Take dominion over everything, and rule over it, and be fruitful, and multiply. out of this dominion and out of this fruitful multiply, tend as you go. Keep it. Don't allow it to be destroyed. Don't allow it to be consumerized. Don't allow it to be preserved forever. Use and put back. It's called conservation. It's a great topic. If everybody would just get on it. We once did that. We used to call our officers in the woods conservation officers. Who remembers that? Not anymore. Now it's all about preservation, or just use it and who cares? And what command were they given not to do? Just one. Don't eat of what? Don't tempt me by going and looking at evil and trying to figure it out. That's really what it was. Do not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. What do we do? What do children do? The minute they have a chance, what do? They have this nature in them that's fallen, and they immediately want to go and do everything that is absolutely wrong. And you just go, you can't remember yourself doing it, but you did. My mom once told me, you're yelling at the grandkids, and you used to do the very same thing. Well, Mom, do I let them burn their hand off? She'd always say the same thing. Don't be ridiculous. So what are the essential truths here? When we look at this concept, what are the essential truths? I want you to remember this as we go through them all. God cannot break his promises. How many people are happy about that? He cannot break his covenants, or he is not God. See, he's actually evil if he does. God must create a seamless, handed-down set of covenants and promises. He must. Otherwise, they become null and void. Now, why do I make this point? Because people will say this: now that we're in the New Testament, the Old Testament is null and void. No. No, 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 no. Maybe certain little things like a kosher law or, you know, a circumcision or something like that, because it's an option now. Most things are not option now. Which commandment is an option now? Amen. Brian. Oh, I'll just go kill somebody, but I won't lie. How stupid does that sound? Right? I'll just break this one law here of sexuality, but I'll keep all the other ones because I happen to have a tendency to like this. Tell that to the little child who was molested. What part of that's any good? How about this? If God can't keep all that he said, he's not God. And how about if everything he ever said dovetails into something else and just gets a bigger picture? That's really what's happening here. As we learn from creation all the way to Christ, you know what happens? We get a bigger picture of who he is because his covenantal promise is more revealed. More revealed. Who knows what I'm talking about? And you start to see God in a bigger and better way, right? You start to understand more about him. And so if anything is null and void, it's over with. And some people will say immediately, this is jumping ahead just for a moment so you get an idea. Well, then we cannot celebrate the festival of Yom Kippur because it's the Feast of the Atonement and God died on the cross once for all. Truth. Truth. But did you know you don't know the Feast of Atonement? That's only one aspect of it. You know what the other part is? Tearing the veil. He did that too. He said, well, look, I'm winning. No, you're not. There's a third part. He has to reveal the apocalypse. He has to reveal the end of time. And he has to appear in it among all the clouds of heaven. Has he done that yet? Yes or no? Come on, people. Are we waiting for it? That song was just saying, we believe he will come back, right? When he does that, guess what? Yom Kippur is finished. Jesus did two of the three things while he was on earth. He'll complete the third when he returns. And this is why I'm talking about these festivals in this learning. So before you go cutting off, I know, you do not know, you have not studied, and you need to. In this, God cannot stop a single thing he promised. Can he fulfill parts of the covenant with a new one? Yes, he can, the blood of Christ. Those two portions of Yom Kippur are over forever. But he didn't complete number three. Uh-oh is right. And so watch this. He cannot just start interrupting what he did. He cannot. He also can't instruct you to do something forever if he plans to cut it off. Now watch, number three, if God fulfills his covenantal promise, if he actually fulfills it, he must make another one either to supersede parts of it or complete parts of it, because it cannot cease. So when Christ came and he said, this is the blood in my new covenant, he was absolutely right, because he was going to do something. He was going to end all the sacrifices. Amen? One death, one blood, for all time, for all sin. Everybody with me? But that did not complete the full day. It completed two-thirds of the day. And Christ knew it. And that's why he also said, I did not come to take away any part of the law, but to fulfill it. So while we're waiting, there's more to come. Part of learning is being able to step up on these stones that I'm talking about as we go and eventually get this view where you see everything clearly from all ends. When you're studying the book of Revelation, that's really important. Those of you that are studying it with me realize something. You've been taught to look for all these things like a rapture or this or that. It's like bunny hopping and picking out things you'd like to see happen. It has no basis on what the whole thing says altogether. And what one can never do is start proofreading. Watch this. I found a verse that makes my point when there are 32 verses against you. It's called proofreading, proof texting. It's what the White House does. It's what our congressmen do. It's what our local officials do. They find one thing, they hammer away at it because that's what they want to happen, even though the vast majority of the evidence says, probably not a good idea. Who knows what I'm talking about? Our schools indoctrinate one way, whether it be evolution or whether it be the value of life and abortion and pregnancy and everything else. Why? Because they really believe their way is right. But guess what? There's a way that seems right to men, and the end leads only to... Yes? And so when we deal with these essential truths, they're essential. You cannot go throwing them away. And yet we have so many churches that say, I don't spend any time in the Old Testament, it's irrelevant. Well, the whole history of why Christ came, the whole reason he had to come, the whole thing he had to fulfill is all in one book, and it's not the New. The New tells you how it was done. Amen? You can't throw away the history. Number four, it is possible for God to fulfill part of a covenant and not do it all and finish it later, leaving some for a later date. Number five, the covenantal imagery and worship of that day or of that Sabbath like Sunday today may still have great import for those in relationship with God or those who will come into relationship with God later through you. In other words, if you understand what you really believe, and if you really, really remember all that needs to be remembered, then you'll be able to talk to people about what they don't know and what they cannot remember and what they don't believe in because they do not know. Now, I know I said that kind of fast, but did everybody get that? You can't talk unless you know, or you're talking out of the side of your mouth. Who's ever heard that concept? There's another word that I won't use. But we hear it all the time. People constantly just talking as if they know something. They know nothing. When I listen to people, I quickly do this. Are you kidding me? That was defeated 6 times to China in 698 AD. Bye. You don't know. You just don't know, do you? I can't believe you're bringing that concept back. It destroyed the world 3 times. The sacrifice of the unborn to gods and pagan gods like Molech and others, and burning the babies in the fire, we're still doing it. Have we learned anything? Have we learned anything? And we have those advocating for the full right to do this even after they're born now. You see, when we don't know, when we don't believe, and we don't remember, we don't know how to defeat this. It's simple. It's always been against God. It's always been a culture of death. God is a God of life. He has no part in this, and I don't care how it happened to you. One sin doesn't make another. There's the other argument, right? Well, I'm sorry. What a terrible thing to happen to you. But it doesn't give you the right to commit murder. I was robbed, so I killed the guy. Did you have to subdue him? No, I could have held a gunpoint till the cops came, but I felt like it. Does that make it right? You might want to, but does it make it right? And the answer is no, it's what? Murder. Yes or no? It does not change a thing. And so what we got to remember here when we're studying these things is that there is a way to do it. The covenantal imagery of these festivals, the covenantal imagery of Sunday morning, the Sabbath for us, the covenantal imagery of the singing we just did before the throne of God, the covenantal imagery of hearing his word and understanding it continues and continues and continues, and it must, or the next generation will never hear, and no one in the future will believe, and no one will remember, and the name of God, what will happen to it? It will cease. Who's been trying to stop the name of God from being spoken, remembered, or taught forever? Satan. The long war against the name of God. He's taken it out of the public square. He's taken it out of public meetings. He's taken it out of the army. I resigned because they told me I could not preach the name of Christ in public anymore. I had to be in a church setting before I could announce it. And here I am, a representative of God as an officer, as a United States Army chaplain. They knew what they were doing. They were trying to get rid of those who spoke the name. They wanted the career officer who wanted his pension and was a health and morale guy and made people feel good. That's who they wanted to be chaplains. But they did it. They changed the law. They changed it in the Senate, in the Congress. They are no longer allowed to invoke the name of Christ openly very much anymore at all. And when they do, they are never invited back. It used to be they had to hear the word of God before they made a decision. Right from the beginning, we did not keep the commandments. We all know the story. That fruit looks good. I'm not going to get into whether it was an actual tree. It probably was. It was a serpent. What does that mean? I mean, it used to have legs and now it doesn't. That doesn't make it a snake because snakes already existed. Okay? I don't know. I'm not going to get into all the imagery of it. But fact is, we loved selfishness and we wanted what we wanted and we still do more than what God tells us to do. And that's the basis for all of our problems. Yes? I mean, we call it sin, and that's a great name for it, but, you know, my grandmother used to say, what's sin? Watch this. It's when the I becomes capitalized in the word. Small s, who sees it? Big I, small n. It's when I am better than the I am. It's when I have a better idea than the I am. It's when I'm going to do what I want to, even though the I am told me not to. Everybody kind of agree with that definition? I like that definition. It's when I becomes more important. We all fell. We do it all the time. Sometimes we don't think any of it, and that's not good. But God, right from the beginning, said this, I will bring one born of you who will also be born of me. And while the snake tries to bite your heel, he will crush his head. It was the first time God introduced his real plan of redemption. He didn't even wait. In the very day they fell, he announced a promise that would save them. He's never taken by surprise. He has it all figured out. And then we were waiting for what? A child to be born. We couldn't figure out the rest because we didn't have enough to go by, but we started to believe we had some hope. And what's necessary in the world? Hope. Because when we see him face to face, will we need it? No. In the end, three things remain: faith, hope, and love. But which of the two will no longer be necessary when you see God face to face? If we could just ask our loved ones one second, the ones who went before us, you know what they'd say? Faith is no longer needed. Now I see, just as I am seen. Amen? Didn't Paul kind of say that? Now I see dimly in a mirror, but then one day face to face. And what else is it needed? Hope. Why would you need hope if hope is standing in front of you? But what will you experience from God forever and ever? And what will you experience from others? Love. How many people realize you're created for relationship, and when you're alone, you don't do very good very long? Now, man, I know what we try to do. I'll get a couple days away from this whole thing, and I'll be good. But you know what we do? Then we're lonely. It was the same problem we had when we were naming animals on the sixth day. We got to the end of the list, and we said, where's the one that looks like me? And by the end of the day, we were going, well, and he's like, I know. I knew you'd get to this, but I wanted you to get to this on your own. How many people see right from the beginning God didn't leave us without a hope and a promise? It's not a covenant. It's a promise. It's a covenantal promise, but it's not a covenant. It's a promise. I think one of our music leaders there today talked about promises, right? Amen. Good job, Greg. God's original creation and commands and promises are still in effect. How many people are happy about that statement? Right from that very first one, all the way to today, I'm coming back. Now, what would it have been like, imagine for me one moment, if God never made that promise? What would it have been like for Adam and Eve having children if he never made them that promise? They'd have walked around like this all day long. Doomed, doomed, doomed. I'm going to die. Doomed. Wouldn't they? If all you knew is you were going to die now and there was no other thing, what would you do? Do you know how many people commit suicide every day because they get there to that moment when all they can see is doomed, doomed, because they haven't heard the good news? All right, so the next covenantal promise is to whom? Noah. It's not a covenant. It's a promise. It has a covenantal sign with the promise. It's called the rainbow, and that's been what lately? Co-opted. It's a good word. Good science word. Good math word. Co-opted. They take it and use it for a different purpose. But whenever you do that, you have to alter it. How many people realize there's six colors in their rainbow and there's seven in the original? What do we know about numbers? Six is what? Inherently what? If you get too many of them. Evil, incomplete. It's incomplete, so it's evil. Seven is complete, so we know it's good. Do you know what color is missing? The different shade of blue-purple. We have a name for that. Indigo. I've always wondered what the heck indigo is. That's what it is. It's kind of a weird blue-purple. Right? Roy G. Biv. Anybody remember being taught that way, like by old scientists? Right? Red, orange, yellow. B for... right? R for green and Biv, blue, indigo, and violet, Roy G. Biv. My first science teacher was a nun, and she said, just remember, it's a guy named Roy, his middle initials G, and his last name is Biv. So what did I do? I went home and took her seriously. I went home, I said, hey, I learned something today. The colors are Roy G. Biv. He's a cool dude. His first name is Roy, his middle name is G, and his last name is Biv. But they took indigo out. You know why? What color is blue-purple when it's put together? It's called royal purple. And who will wear that when he comes? And who will judge you upon his throne wearing that robe? Do you ever notice why they chose that one? You know what they said? Well, there's kind of a blue already. There's kind of a purple already. We don't need it. No. The devil said, take out one. Take out indigo. Very precise attack. The covenantal promise to Noah goes like this. I'm fed up. I'm going to do something about it, but I'm not going to hide it from you because you truly believe, you truly remember, and you truly follow. I just replaced a lot of paraphrasing, but did you hear it? One man believed. Doesn't say his family did. They might have. They might have had some, but it doesn't say they believed like he did. And it also says he remembered and he lived it. Therefore, he was, even though he sinned sometimes, he was considered blameless. I shall not hide it from this one. And through this one, here comes an archetype of Christ, I will save the world. And he did it. He built a boat, put everybody on it, boom. Okay? And the world was saved in those days. Then we see the beautiful rainbow as a promise. What? I will never flood the earth. Now watch. Let's go back to our original premise. Suppose God didn't make that promise. The next time it rained, what would people think? Uh-oh, here we go again. But what did he say? I will never flood the entire earth again. Every time you see this, you can remember, I will keep my word. Right? So what was it? Another hope. Another hope. We've seen floods. We've seen them in Florida. We've seen them in other places. Is everything okay? Pretty good? Awesome. I prayed for that and others. What's going on here, though, is that God once again continued the first promise. I will not destroy everything. I will always have a way out. You know what the ark was? A chance to get on board. You know what people said? It'll never happen. That's what they're doing today. Do you know that? The end? Where is he? Where is this one who is coming? They mock and they scoff and they shake their fist at heaven. They're about to get an answer. They don't know it. But it may have happened this week. Anybody know what happened on October the 9th? Every planet was in the same house and every star was in the same alignment and the moon was under the feet of the woman, of the virgin, and the sign of Revelation chapter 12, verses 1 to 5, was in every detail, just the same as he was born. Remember somebody telling you this a few years back, it was about to happen? I didn't bring it up last week. I didn't bring it up this week, but I'm going to bring it up now. It happened. And you know what happened that same moment? On the 8th, the alignment of the Draconoid meteor shower aligned with it on the back of that dragon. And he shook his scales all throughout the 8th and the 9th, and all the stars came falling down to earth. And you know what happened at that same moment that no one was ready for, that no one knew was coming, that NASA didn't know? Our sun ejected the largest corona solar flare from its interior core, called a coronal ejection, the largest one ever recorded on the same day that the dragon was shaking his scales. It caused a G5 to G7 storm that went all the way from the North Pole all the way to the panhandle of Florida and all around the world at that level. Imagine that. Imagine how many countries saw that. You know, we said, oh, look, a red aurora borealis. Who saw it on the 9th and the 10th? I got lots of pictures from friends, myself, and everybody else. Somebody told me about it while I was working with another guy, and I went outside and took some more. You know how many times the aurora borealis is bright red? Try never. Try its green. Try its yellow. Try its blue. I know this. I grew up in aurora borealis heaven. It's called Michigan. And we didn't get a chance to play the Yankees this year, but it was close. All right. Congratulations to all you Yankees fans with Cleveland. Listen to me. It was so bright red, it looked like blood. Anybody really see it? Now the hem, the bottom of it, called the hem of his garment, by the way. His robe fills the temple. Aurora borealis is actually a little vision of heaven, too. That yellow was at the bottom. The glory of God was still trying to shine through the blood. Look carefully. At other times, it streaked and went green and yellow, and you saw like spirits and angels, almost like visions coming out of it. The farther north you went, the more lighter it became. The further south you went, the more blood red it became, including New Jersey. All you saw was a pink-red hue. Anybody seen it for sure? I'll show you pictures if you haven't. Now, I bring this up to tell you something. Something happened. We may not see the effect of it, but something happened. Because whatever happens in heaven happens on the earth right after it. You see, the dragon was trying to shake his scales onto the earth. He was trying to take over. At the same moment, Christ was saying, watch, even in this, I am reflected in the heavens, and I am coming too. Remember that as we go forward. Rainbows, signs in the heavens, they're forever. Just imagine if God never made this promise to us. Moving on. Abraham. Now watch this one. Imagine if God didn't get a ram while he's ready to kill Isaac. Here we are, getting ready to kill Isaac, right? Imagine the knife's coming down, but no ram appears. What does Abraham do? Scripture's very clear. He was going to kill him. Would there be any descendants of the Jews today? Would Christ be able to come? But what happened in that moment? Suddenly a ram appeared, caught by its own horns. And God provided a way out. An unblemished, perfect ram. A symbol of what was to come. On the very mountain he did that, Moriah, renamed Golgotha, a male ram came, unblemished, and died on a cross. The promise was continued. It was never nullified. It was, part of it wasn't thrown out. The chain keeps going. Who sees it? But who sees that every time you see it, you get a bigger vision of God? Who sees it that every time something else is revealed, you get a bigger image of what he's going to do? You see how this all works together? It's awesome. The higher you step on the next stone, the more you see. And the more you understand, and the more you grasp how great God is. Imagine if God had not done that, either with Jesus or with Abraham. All right, now what about the next one? Joseph. What about this one? Anybody? Come on. It's just a promise through a vision. It's not a covenant, but it's important. Would there be any Jewish people in the world if God did not do what he did here? Answers? This is where I would insert a clicker page, and you'd have choices. It would go something like this. Famine kills all the Jews. You know, next choice. What would have happened if God wouldn't have had Joseph see the visions to tell them what was going to happen? And then what would have happened if he hadn't fulfilled those visions? All the Jewish people would be dead. Would Jesus be allowed to come? No. Would there be a promised line from Judah? No. Who was involved in the whole thing? Judah. But who ended up saying, take me instead? Judah. Read the story. I know it's big. But there's more to it. What would have happened to the whole known world of those days had God not put him in charge of Egypt? The pagans wouldn't have been around with all their gods and all their religions to find out about Christ later. God didn't just save the Jews through Joseph. He saved the whole known world. Go back and read it. One man, faithful. One man watching. One man believing. One man remembering. Who keeps seeing it's always one person? Is that you? Are you that one person? Will you believe? Will you remember? All right, we're moving on. Moses. Moses, part of the way through his life, watched the Hebrew being killed, and he beat the pulp out of that guard. Literally beat the pulp out of him, right down to the brain. Killed him. Ran away because he was a wanted man. Figured, the heck with this, I'm out of here. He gets all the way out to Midian in the middle of the desert. Another 40 years of his life goes by, and he says, I'm safe. No one's coming after me. The posse ain't coming. Ever think about it that way? I've been hiding out for 40 years, and no one knows I did it. I've been hiding out for 40 years, and God doesn't want me to do anything. I'm safe. You know what I can do? I can retire. You know what I can do? I can stop believing, and I can stop remembering. Then what? Burning bush. It's like you're driving down the highway on 95 to go south, and then suddenly you see something on the side of the road, and you have to stop. You're on your way. I want to get to the Carolinas. I want to get to Florida. But something happens. And crazy Moses goes, I got to see this thing. Big mistake, Moses. Take off your shoes. For the place where you stand is holy ground. I'm going to make you believe, and I'm going to make you remember everything that happened before you. And I'm going to recall to you that I know what's going on right now, and I knew what was happening back then, and I'm coming down, and I'm going to do something about it. Amen? Gets Moses to what? Go back to Egypt, where he didn't want to go. Why? He needed to be there to do what? Get the people out of slavery, get the people out of bondage, get the people going. And we have our first festival, by the way, the Exodus, which is unleavened bread and Passover. So begins, before even a first commandment, a covenant with God based on a festival before a commandment. Very, very interesting, by the way. Just want to put that out there. We'll come back to that. You hear what I said? He invented two festivals, two special Sabbaths, before he ever gave the Ten Commandments and all the rules for a tabernacle. Yes or no? What was God doing? Okay, first covenant. You can read about this if you want to read approximately 40 chapters of material, 45 chapters of material. You need to read from Exodus 19 to the end. You need to read all of Leviticus. There's a little bit in Numbers, but for the most part, if you read that, here's what you'll find out. There's a very specific way to worship me. You'll build a building and you'll have all these exact measurements. You'll have all these little things in it. You will do exactly as I say, when I say exactly when, and offer this and offer that. Why? A word picture. You know what we need as humans? Word pictures. If I don't show you a picture, you don't remember. Now you say, Pastor, why didn't you put some pictures in? Because this message caused me to be sick the last 2 days, so I couldn't give it. I barely had enough strength to wake up this morning to get here. The devil took me down and out. Starting Friday morning until probably about an hour before I woke up. No time to, by the way, I wrote this while I was sick. And so here's the concept. He doesn't want you to hear this. That through all those old covenants, there are images that lead you to understand Christ in a much more full way. There are images throughout that covenant, throughout that temple, throughout those festivals, throughout all those things to show you every aspect of who Christ is, everything Christ was called to do, everything Christ has fulfilled, and everything Christ will fulfill when you see him among all the clouds of heaven. And the whole book of Revelation besides. And Daniel, and the minor prophets, and the major prophets that still haven't come true. All in imagery. And if you don't know the images, you don't understand the concept. And if you don't understand the concept, you don't see Christ. Not the way you should. You only see a little bit. You don't see the whole thing. You know what God wants you to see? His complete glory. Who can't wait for that? But it can start now if I study, if I believe, I remember, and I tell. Okay, now, God had a covenant, but guess who broke it? Guess. Guess who broke it? Point to yourself. People. You know, God would be all set if he just didn't create people. He'd be great without me. He is great without me. He'd be great if I died right now. He'd be great forever. He doesn't need me. He chooses to use me. How many people are pretty humbled by that? But if we don't do our part, we let God down because he limits himself through people. In my non-planning, in my trying to rush ahead with this festivals, in trying to do too much, I was in the way of God, even though God had a plan for the whole thing. Bingo. How many people like to admit things like that? That feels really good, doesn't it? But it's true. So God showed me this whole syllabus in 1 hour. This is how you'll fix it. Now, who broke it? We did. When did we break it? The Babylonian captivity. Actually, for hundreds of years, we weren't keeping it. We were all sinning like whatever we wanted to do. But finally, God called in the chips, if you will. He's about to do that to our country, too. It's called the national debt. We're about to get called in on it. Everybody know what's going to happen? You can see it. It's all going to crumble. That's what happened to the temple. And he carried him away into Babylon for what? 70 years. And during that time, he already had a plan to recreate the temple. He already had a plan to bring back the covenant. He already had a plan through people like Daniel and others, Meshach, Shadrach, Abednego, Elijah, Jeremiah. He kept moving forward, but he had to set us back to teach us a lesson. You don't keep it, you pay. And if you don't have it, you can't be saved. So here we go. Watch. No covenant. What's that mean? Imagine being a Jew this morning and having no temple. You cannot sacrifice for sin. You do not know that Christ did it all. Where are you living? Doom. Doom. Imagine being a Jew this morning. It's worse than being a Muslim. They're just deceived. A Jew knows and can't do anything about it. You ever stop to think how important it is to preach to all these people? One's so deluded, they have their own set of temples that don't even matter, and the other one doesn't have a temple, and they're still trying to make it happen. And who's the temple? The risen, resurrected Christ. Can you see it? Do you understand something? They're still trying to make it happen. They broke it, and God rebuilt it. You know what he did? He called Ezra, he called Nehemiah, and a bunch of boys and girls. And even the ladies carried swords and gave food while the men worked. Anybody ever read that story of rebuilding the wall, rebuilding the temple? And then they rejoiced because God was back with them, and they started moving forward again. All right? But God's covenant of Yom Kippur, the festival, was broken a second time. They broke it again. When did the Jewish people break it again? Everybody can see where these clickers would go, wouldn't they? Hear the silence? I could put a little clicker slide in there right now. That's how I'm planning it. I'm actually planning this out. Come on. I'll give you some choices. They did it again during the 400 years of silence of Malachi. Somebody else did it to them. They didn't want it, but it happened. Jesus came, and they killed him. Number four, none of the above. Who wants number three? They killed Jesus and they weren't supposed to, but they were supposed to, but they did it for the wrong reasons. Yeah. Who sees it? Who sees it now? Crucify him. Crucify him. They were thinking, get rid of him. But what was he doing at the moment they were doing the wrong thing? He was fulfilling it. Anybody see that? Anybody just see that for a moment? If you'd have been there, I got news for you. You would have yelled, crucify him, because I've done it to him 1,000 times. Amen? And what did he do? He went anyway. He went to the cross, silent as a lamb before the shearer. So they broke it again, but and tried to blame it on the Gentiles, but the long and the short of it is this: God fulfilled 2/3 of that covenant that day, opened up the gates of heaven again, opened up the curtain between the Holy of Holies, brought us into a new covenant of his blood, washed away our sins, gave us new life, resurrected from the dead, promised us that in the future, and now we have what? Incredible hope. Who sees, though, if I don't have all the stepping stones before it? It makes no sense when I get to that moment. Anybody see it now? Now, I know I did this really fast this morning, but everybody see it? If you take away any part of it, you missed it. And by the way, we're human. And I'm going to say we're almost to the end of this message, so I'm almost there, but listen to me. Are you ready? We're creatures of habit. If I don't repeat over and over to you, you will forget. You forget sometimes, and I forget sometimes why we walked into the kitchen. Who's with me? It was just for a cup of coffee. I'm holding the cup. It's empty. The percolator is... What about this one? What's happening to our country? Everybody's forgotten. Divide and conquer, because they've forgotten. Because they do not remember from what they came from. They came from religious men and women who loved the Lord and wrote a document that was sacred. The Constitution isn't man-made. It's God-written. Unlike any other country on the face of the earth, we actually have a covenantal document, and we're disgracing it to the nth degree because we do not remember. And not enough people are, and people are being warped and being taught wrong. How important is our job now as Christians to believe, remember, and tell? Yom Kippur still does this. Watch. The final veil to be removed is the apocalypse. To unveil in Hebrew is to, you translate to Greek, is eopakeine, remove the vision, remove the separation. so you can see behind the curtain. That's what Revelation is. Seeing behind the curtain yet to come. And who will be there in the final curtain when the clouds part? Who will be standing there on a white horse with all the angels? Who can't wait for that one? Who can't wait for every loved one marked by the sign of faith to be in the train? Huh? Not yet happened, but when Mama goes, can you imagine Mama coming for you? Can you imagine seeing Andrew coming for you? Can you imagine seeing all your loved ones coming for you? Smiling ear to ear. Not Cheshire grin, smile. The smile of, it's finished. Amen? In the meantime, you got to believe and study and remember and tell. And believe and remember and study and tell. And you can't forget any of it. And you can't let any of it go. In that moment, though, the new covenant was formed. Now, for all those that want to argue covenants, listen to me. The only new covenant is this. Our sins are forever forgiven, but that's really, really important. That's a big change. We don't have to keep sacrificing. We don't have to keep redoing. Christ did it once for all. The gates of heaven are opened once for all. The way to eternal life is open now for all. But do you understand something? It's only one part of one festival. And look how great it is. It changes everything, yes or no? I mean, who can defeat that hope? What could take that away from you? Not famine, not sword, not imprisonment, not peril. In all these things, he has made you more than conquerors through him. Do you hear Paul now in context? See, you got to put these things in context. Paul doesn't just make that statement and go, well, that sounds pretty good. Paul's pretty fired up. He sees it. You know when he announced it? Yom Kippur. You know when he told the Gentiles? Look what Christ has done for you. You know what he told the Jews? Look what Christ has done for you. There is no more Gentile nor Jew. There is no more free nor slave. There's no more man nor woman. All these gates have been broken down by this. Now watch. Jews have been languishing ever since a certain date, 70 AD. You wait till I tell you the story of 40 years of Yom Kippur gone wrong. Starting in the year 30, when Jesus died, and ending in the year 70. From 31 to 70, every one of their feasts went wrong. I'd have to take an hour to explain to you how it went wrong, so when I get there, I will. But there was a sign to them that it wasn't working. A sign right on the door of the temple was not changing like it's supposed to, and the dice were in the wrong hand of the rabbi when he cast the lot. 40 straight years. A warning that we no longer should be doing this part of the covenant anymore. We should move on to the last part, the revelation of all times. And then guess what happened? When the 40th one went wrong, the temple was destroyed the very same day by Titus and Pompey. And Vespian, on the very day that it happened. Can't write this stuff. It's in the Talmud. It's in the Mishnah. Original covenant, all the promises and fulfillment of the new covenant are still with us today. All the way back to the moment Adam and Eve were born, all the way to today. And you know how we celebrate one of them? We get to church on Sunday morning. 6 days shall you work, 1 day shall you rest and worship me. Yes or no? What are you doing here this morning? You're obeying the covenant. You're obeying the command. Some of you came just so you could smile and talk to each other. Some of you are saying, if you hurry up, I'll still have time. And yet, all of the festivals and holy days still show us the whole unbelieving world. See, here's what Paul said. Here's what John said. Miracles are not for the believers. They're for the unbeliever. The imagery isn't for the believer. He already believes. Although he gets something out of it, it's for the unbeliever to see what's really happening. It's crazy how they make these statements. But the whole way of salvation to Christ, for the Jew who's still trying to build a temple, the whole way to Christ, for the Islamic person who's so deluded, they're not even worshiping the same God and think they are. Yeah. For the Buddhist, for the Hindu, for anybody who's following after some other covenantal-like system of false gods and doesn't see, if we follow it the right way and if we teach it the right way, they will see. Isn't that cool? If we just go through the year and go through the year and go through the week by week with the Sabbath, then the special ones, and we just keep worshiping the way we're supposed to, the whole world will see. And we'll see better. How many people realize you got to do what the Feast of Trumpets do? You got to take an inventory of where you're at all the time and fix things. How many people realize they haven't gotten perfected yet? So what's wrong with that one? That's actually one we should do a lot. But it also announces the prophetic days yet to come. Every one of those festivals has a missing part still. Wait till I show it to you. All the eight parts will be fulfilled the day Christ comes through the clouds. And final judgment happens on that same day. When that judgment's over, the festivals will be finished. And yet Christ still says this, let's just keep worshiping together anyway. Sit down at my table. At least the Passover and unleavened bread continue. Because he himself said he'd partake of it with you in the new heavenly kingdom. And maybe that's the only one we do. Maybe it's just the last one. Maybe we finally passed over. Everybody just see that for a moment? Think about the loved one you love the most, and they passed over. Aren't you happy for them? Can't you wait to be with them? Can't you wait till this is over? I'm sorry, some of it I'd like to have it over with. Amen? No more struggle, no more going to work, no more writing the next thing, no more trying to find the next paycheck, no more seeing the price of water go up again, just water, but there's no inflation. It's now $7.28 at Walmart for a 5-gallon. When Trump left office, it was $5. Went up 28 cents this week, just for water. Okay, including the final aspect of Yom Kippur, which we'll be seeing him in the heavens. Okay, all right. Here we go. So what do we got to do? We got to believe. We got to remember. God. We got to remember God's faithfulness and believe in it. We got to remember God's goodness and know it's true. We got to walk in holiness as he is holy. We've got to make a promise and a covenant ourselves that we will not bail when things get rough. We got to make a promise and a covenant that while it's still good, we will study and learn and believe and remember and tell. We have a responsibility in this covenant. The whole span of history is ours to learn. And you might say, I am 40, I am 50, I am 60, I am 70. There's no way. And the answer is right, but if you do that, you're copping out. I hang on my timeline that I started when I was 4 years old of history. I've been hanging stuff from it for 55 years. And when I learn something new, I hang it again. And when someone says no, I say, wrong. You don't know. So shut your mouth and learn. It's not too late to learn the history of the Bible. But you got to study like crazy. How much time are we spending every week studying the only thing we can study? The Word of God recorded. Not to mention the Word of God made flesh, who's actually a person. How much time are we doing? Come on. If you know what, you know what Paul says? Gird up your loins. Tie up that cloth. Weaken those feeble knees. Weaken those feeble elbows. And get busy. That's what he says. Book of Hebrews, about a coming priest, high priest. People's lives are at stake. What you learn, what you believe, what you remember, what you tell, people's souls are at stake. It's everything. Let's sing this final song about this message. We believe, now we remember. Whoops, went too far. Go ahead. No. Okay.
lives were changed. We remember. How could we forget the promise of hope in that trumpet sound?
Final song now with our music team. I give you my heart.
This song has a lot of special meaning for me because it's impossible for me to achieve what this song talks about. But that doesn't mean you never stop striving. If there's one song that I would like to have played at my funeral when that time comes, it would be this song. You could sit while we play it. Worship you.
Lord, we thank you for another beautiful day in your house. We thank you for the opportunity to come into your presence and one another's presence and be all together. And Lord, I ask this week that all of us could answer that last song with all that we are. That each and every day that would be our hope, that would be our intent, and that would be everything that we strive for, to give ourselves to you, to your will, and to your way. Help us, Lord, to believe more than we ever have before. Help us to learn and to remember like never before. And help us to tell what we believe and remember so that you are high and lifted up, you are glorified, and people see only you. To you be all glory in the church forevermore, Lord Jesus Christ. And all of God's people said, amen. Have a great week in the Lord.
Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul, I live for you alone, every breath that I take. Moment I'm away, Lord, have your way in me. Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul. I live for you alone, every breath that I take. Moment I'm away, Lord, have your way in me.